Dear brothers and sisters, in our risen Christ, grace to you and peace in his name. Amen. Let's see, for some of you anyway, you have had several weeks of training under your belt, so let's see how this goes. Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed. Hallelujah.
Pretty good, pretty good. There was a pastor who was teaching the resurrection to a group of second graders, and he asked them this question. What did Jesus say immediately after he came out of the grave? And one young girl shot her arm up with great intensity and said, I know exactly what he said. And the pastor said, well, what was that? And she jumped up and said, ta-da! Now, she may not have been factually accurate, but this little girl gets Easter. She gets what it's all about. Not all of us get that life-changing, exuberant joy of the resurrection all that well or maybe all that quickly. If you've ever struggled with your faith, if you've ever been judgmental, if you've ever been impatient, if you've ever been stuck your well-intentioned foot in your mouth, then you are in good company along with Peter in our lesson today. Our lesson has been referred to as conversion of Cornelius, and that is true. But Peter is the one who I think has changed the most in this story. But before I go any further, I just want to make sure that we are all on the same page, as it were. You see, we're doing a little bit of a loop-de-loop when it comes to our narrative flow at this point. As you've noticed, we are now out of the Gospel of Matthew and into the book of Acts. And we're well into the book of Acts. We have skipped over some very interesting and very preeminent points of the story, and we will loop back to those so that we can share those holidays of the Ascension and of Pentecost, and we will read those stories at that time. But as I mentioned, we find ourselves today in the 10th chapter of Acts, and here the apostles and the early believers are trying to figure out just exactly what does it mean to be the church, to be the followers of a risen Lord Jesus Christ. The first thing I'd like you to ponder today is that the church as a people of faith are always playing catch up with where God has already been. Take Cornelius, for instance. He was a centurion of the Roman or the Italian cohort. And if this was an old Western novel, he would be the villain. He is an invader, a Roman, an Italian Roman at that, which meant he was likely from the area around Calabria, which is a southern region around Rome, not just a pizza place on Main Street, all right? Long before Peter or any Christian is brought into the story, God is already at work. Cornelius, though not Jewish, we are told, however, that he was devout in worship, prayers, and in his offerings. He was known as a God-fearer, not a Hebrew, not a Jew, but one who worshiped God as they did, even though he was a Gentile. God had been at work in this man and his family long before our story opens. In our lesson today, Cornelius was praying at 3:00 in the afternoon, an official time of prayer amongst devout Jews. And he has this startlingly clear vision. He is told that God has heard his prayers and seen his faithful generosity, and that he is to have his people get Simon, who is called Peter, who is in Joppa. For those of you who are biblical trivia buffs, today that town is known as Jaffa, not Joppa, but Jaffa, and it's right next to modern-day Tel Aviv in Israel. It is the same port town from which Jonah sailed the other direction when God told him to go to Nineveh. But back to our story. So Cornelius does what he is told, and he sends his people off some 30 miles or so from his house to go find Simon Peter in Joppa. Meanwhile, Simon Peter is indeed hanging out in Joppa, and around noon the next day, he is up on the roof praying when he finds himself into a trance as he waits for his lunch. And he has this vision as well, but this vision is anything but clear for Peter. What he sees is odd. It is a sheet filled with all sorts of critters. A seminary friend of mine called it a meat blanket. It is descending from heaven along with a command to kill and eat. Peter sees this veritable buffet that would put the sizzler's menu to shame, but there's nothing kosher on the menu. And if you want to know what is on that list, you can go back to Leviticus 11 and there's a complete listing there. But Peter sees what's there and he replies to the invitation to this smorgasbord by saying, "By no means, Lord, for I have never eaten anything profane or unclean." And the voice said to him again a second time, "What God has made clean, you must not call profane." This happens to him, as it does, seems to happen to Peter a lot, three times. So what to make of this vision? Peter certainly couldn't figure it out, as our lesson tells us. Sitting from Peter's vantage point, we could assume that it's about lunch, but it's about so much more. Christian author Philip Yancey has, to my knowledge, delivered only one children's sermon in his lifetime, and this may be why, because he was preaching on this text. And he came forward for the children's sermon, and as the kids came forward, he brought out from a bag that he brought for the sermon a bag of barbecued pork rinds, a fake snake, a large rubber fly, a container of scallops, and to an equal amount of shrieks, screams, and squeals, a live lobster, which he named Larry. This is why we have rules about the bucket, all right? I don't know how the children's message went. What I do know is he then later preached a sermon entitled, What Did God Have Against Lobster? But the point here is it's not about the lobster. The purity laws of the Old Testament were kept by Peter as they were by most practicing Jews. And for the early church to be a good Christian meant following the old laws of what it meant to be a good Jew. Many of these laws were there for good reasons, for health. Some were just good practices to help focus one's faith lives. The problem, as we will come to see, is that many of these laws also kept people away from people. What we discover then in our reading is this vision about Peter had less to do with food than it was about the relationships we have with one another. That's the second thing I'd like you to notice today. The law becomes less a gift from God than a blunt tool to separate the us's from the them's. Let me explain. If you had a skin disease, you were one of them. You were locked out or kicked out or left to fend for yourself with no community, no care, no nothing. You were not one of us. You became one of them. Bald-headed guys? Yep, we were one of them as well. Women, on a regular basis, at least once a month, became one of them. Or after childbirth, became one of them too. Then there was anyone who had touched the hide of a pig, which is really bad news for anyone who's played football, because you too are them. So when it comes to figuring out what this dream meant, Peter was clueless, but blessedly that didn't last very long. Because as I said in my first point, God is already at work. We jump over a chunk of the story in Acts 10, where Peter is moved down to Cornelius' place. But as he gets there, he points out to Cornelius it's not actually right for him to be in his household, for Peter is an observant Jew and Cornelius is a Gentile, and it is not good for him to be there. But he, to his credit, Peter does say this. He comes into Cornelius' house and says, "Why am I here?" Cornelius recounts his vision once again to Peter, and Peter then responds with the story of Jesus Christ, a story of the good news of the gospel. But first, he begins with the words that are at the tail end of our lesson today. Peter says, "I truly understand that God shows no partiality, no favorites, but in every nation, anyone who fears him and does what is right is acceptable to him." Peter finally gets it. Or he begins, anyway, to get it. So God is there working in advance, planting seeds, setting the stage, and God wants us to see that it is not about us and them at all. It is about all of us in His grace. And lastly, we learn that through all of this, God is indeed patient with us. And I, for one, am thankful for Peter because he is the patron saint for those of us who are dense, for those of us who are slow learners, for those of us who just don't quite get it in time. It only took him watching Jesus reach out to lepers and Gentiles and tax collectors and sinners of every kind with compassion and healing for him to understand that there is no them and us. It only took him a lifetime of living and working with Jesus for him to begin to get this. It only took a miracle of the resurrection, the greatest event that's ever happened in history, for him to start to get it. It only took the gift of the Holy Spirit and a direct intervention from God through a dream for Peter to get it and begin to reach out and live in God's grace. Finally, this is a sign for you and for me of God's divine patience. Long ago, God had promised Abraham that through him all the nations of the world would be blessed. And throughout this long arc of the biblical story, we find that through Jesus Christ, we are given the gifts of God to be a blessing to the world. Some saw that as a setting apart, a separation of the Jews from the rest of the world. But through Jesus Christ, we see that this is indeed a setting apart, but not in the terms of the world. What God in Christ has done is to show us that we are there to be a blessing, to show everyone that there is no one beyond God's loving reach and touch. What Peter finally got was that Jesus was not just a person in the past, but was a person in the present. Peter was busy looking at what was, and God is busy looking to what will yet be. The good news for you and for me is that God has already been at work in our lives. That is why we are here today. So the question is, how will others be blessed because of what God can do in and through us, in our homes, in our communities, and in our workplaces? I'll close with a story from Dr. Tony Campolo, who's one of my favorites. He did a video series called Carpe Diem a number of years back. And he tells about a pastor friend of his who lives in Manhattan. And every morning, this pastor friend would go to breakfast at a little diner downtown. And the usual crew would be there every single morning. Day after day, they all started their day in this diner. And one day, the pastor walked into the diner and he introduced himself to the crowd. Then he asked everyone there to introduce themselves to each other. He was hoping for a little more friendly atmosphere in the place. And it worked. Well, it worked for everyone, that is, except for the owner. All he would reveal about himself was his name, Harry. A few weeks passed, and the regular customers had become friends, and Tony's pastor friend assured and pressured Harry to reveal a little bit more about himself. So Harry reluctantly announced that his real name was in fact Hazim, and that he was from Baghdad, Iraq. Now, this was during a time when Saddam Hussein was a real threat to world security. He had missiles trained on places like Tel Aviv, and a majority of the regular customers at this diner were Jewish. And the tension between Arabs and Jews were running high. All the customers in the diner froze when Harry announced his national origin. The next morning, as the pastor was getting ready for his day, he heard the radio report that the U.S. had begun bombing Baghdad. And the pastor dropped what he was doing and ran to the subway, hoping to reach the diner before Harry opened up that morning. He wanted to reassure the man of his friendship and love. And as the pastor rounded the corner, he saw that the whole regular morning crew was already there, standing on the sidewalk, waiting for Harry. When Harry arrived, the customers surrounded him with hugs and words of encouragement, and then the pastor prayed over all of them. And after the prayer, Harry said gruffly, "You know, you will still have to pay for the donuts. But from now on, the coffee will be free." So the question we're left with this morning is this: who are the Gentiles in your life? Who have you categorized as the them that God categorizes as his beloved? How will you live out God's promises from long ago so that you are blessed, as you are blessed, you might be a blessing to others? Where might the risen Christ be present to you as you learn what his loving grace is all about? And to what unlikely person is God calling you to reach out in love, even as you grow as a disciple of Jesus Christ, our living Lord? For that is what it means to be the church. Amen.